We will introduce the part of the result of the few year methodological reflection on research on rock cut during the Middle Age in Auvergne, center of France. Auvergne is a mountainous region and volcanic, who has been strongly marked by human occupation since the prehistory. During the Middle Ages, human settlements are concentrated on rocky peak and plateau slopes. The particularity of those sites is that most of them are made of two parts, one as a rock cut, castle, and other as a village, constructed on a succession of terraces. Due to their number, studying that type of site is crucial in the comprehension of medieval occupation of the territory and the knowledge of medieval people of this territory. Indeed, it seems that each zone where the type of stone is proper for exploitation is marked by a troglodytic settlement. Studying the site is also a methodological challenge. Many of them are difficult to access, often partially destroyed and under a dense forest cover. Due to the archaeological context itself, such as rock cut, for which traditional survey methods are difficult to apply, and the need of study that type of site is a global logic of landscape appropriation and occupation. In this context, we will present you two cases of study, the site of Châteauneuf and Boissière, and our methodological approaches. So the cave of Châteauneuf are located at more than 800 meters of altitude, carved beneath a castle and of which remain only ruins. The site is implanted on a rocky spur and provides a direct panoramic view, making it a strategic point. At the base of the cliff in which the caves are dug, lay a part of the wall collapsed following the earthquake in the Middle Age. The rocket rooms are dated from the 11th and 12th century by archaeologists. Châteauneuf is currently composed of seven caves. Thanks to 19th century touristic guide, we know of two other cavities that are now collapsed in the vegetation below the slopes after a series of devastating earthquakes. Also important, west of the site, a fortified wall has been discovered and surveyed. Its longest stretch is at least 80 meters long and about 3 meters wide. However, it has not been discovered entirely, but seems to extend towards the northern part of the site. It is also possible to see the remains of the fortification at the top of the site, with perhaps the remain of a curtain wall. On the old site, there are many scree slopes, probably also originated during the Great Middle Age earthquakes. So the particularity of this fortification is that it's mainly built in granite and also with basalt. The builders of the time did not retrieve the stone blocks from the cavities to make fortification. Instead, next to the site, there is a granite quarry which has been used for the fortified wall in Châteauneuf and for the restoration of the church of Saint-Nectaire. The many carved feature over The many carved feature observed in the caves confirm the hypothesis of a dueling. It is also the many comparison made with various sites in Auvergne that allow these results to be confirmed. It is its direct relationship with the fortress certifies that they are not simple duelings, but they are noble duelings, such as various interior arrangement of this medieval cavity suggested. Thus, the cave had several functions, but the most important traces refer to an habitat probably privileged, as evidenced made by the many installations such as a window, rings, supports allowing the suspense falls, ceilings, with the presence of beam holes, post holes, niches, cupboards, etc. So the rock cut sites over Auvergne are often connected to a castle. Here are other closer examples that I will present very quickly. So is the Roche Blanche site with caves dug into the limestones from which it takes its name. We find the remains of an ancient medieval keep and many features. The site of Monton also presents a castle which can be seen on the armorial of Guillaume de Revel, and which makes it possible today the existence of the caves at least to the 14th century. Perrier is a site that offers about 300 cavities. We find the ruins of a watchtower installed on the fairy chimney, and which dominates the whole village. And one of the most spectacular sites is Jonas. The hundreds of cavities are dug in a vertical rocky spur on at least three levels. There are a spiral staircase and a Romanesque chapel with frescoes. It is one of the only rocky, it is one of the only rock cut sites with a religious vocation in the Auvergne region. So the analysis therefore require an interpretation of the function of rocket sites according to time. So for the Middle Age, we observe the establishment of the site. That is to say that the sites settled down, so are created, and begin to develop at this period. Here the dating elements are provided by the ceramics. In 11th, 12th century, the feudal system was set up and the first castles appeared. Castles are thus associated to almost all troglodytic sites. For the 13th and 15th centuries, the castle and religious functions continued and the seigneurial settlement was consolidated. This habitat will continue during the modern period, but some sites will be used as refuges, others for agricultural purposes, and still others are certainly abandoned. So during the 19th, 20th centuries, some sites are still used as habitats, others are used as quarries or workshops. Most sites become touristic in the 21st century. Only a few sites remain used for agricultural purposes. Now I will let Antoine talk about the medieval village and our methodological approaches.
Okay. Firstly, I apologize for my rude English. Everyone will understand. So, like Constance said, studying rock cut site in Auvergne is fundamental. Why? Because in the Middle Age, it seems to have been a condition for the implantation of villages, seigneurial sites. So for that, I will show you the example of the village of Boissière. It's a site made in two parts, with instantly located on the slopes of the plateau de Raja. So it's made of two parts. One is a rock-hewn site, with probably seigneurial, because it has been destroyed by an earthquake, but there is still traces of a pigeon holes. So it confirms this, this purpose. And just under it, a big village with still well preserved because it is under high forest, with installed where the construction are installed on the succession of terraces, and this village with directly linked to the occupied part is very interesting because it seems that the medievals who are settled there knew that the geological context were ugly, unstable. Why? Because we have many evidence that there were houses who have been destroyed during the occupation of the site and rebuilt after that. It's also made probably a system, small system to avoid that the water will come to fill. Film too much other terraces and make it unstable. See, there are many small canalizations who are parallel to each wall of terraces. So, studying those sites is a methodological challenge because first due to the natural context, because it's under forest and you can take pictures, it's only greens and you see nothing. Majority of sites are difficult to access, we have to call some specialists. And due to the archaeological context itself, because cave dwellings are complex structures for which traditional methods of archaeological survey are difficult to apply. And the need to study those sites in a global way, both villages and cave, and in a place in the landscape. So we begin from since a few years in Mural to experiment a new way to analyze the site, where three-dimensional is the biggest part, and I will also present you the virtual visit that we test this year. We can begin to test this year. So three-dimensional is crucial, I think, the best way to study a rock cut cave, because it presents the advantage to be all in one. First one, you have the advantage to volume understanding. You can calculate automatically the volume of a rock of extracted stones, or space organization architecture, and the advantage also to cover to have an entire picture cover of the cave. But it permits also to do some traditional methods, such as a soil plan, a sectional plan, to understand the internal structuration and stratigraphy. And also, you can link it with virtual reality to rebuild some parts who have disappeared. Okay. So it permits also to focus on some architectural elements, on our tool smarts, to make typology, chronology, etc. And so the most interesting things that we begin to test this is virtual visit, because 3D, to use 3D is awesome, but it's also a paradox, because it's we are using high technology, but only in the post-2D, because it takes very long time to calculate on a computer. If you missed something on the field, you have nothing left after. And it's a paradox, because you are still using for the field observation paper and pens, something like that. So this year we begin to try to use virtual visit on a computer, on a tablet for the field work. It's a very simple principle. It's made of panoramic pictures assembled to create an immersive view. So I can show you maybe. Yes, and the result is not bad. And you can take directly field notes on this. So it makes easily to do comparison. And of course, because you have written tablet, if you studied in other caves, in other sites, you can do a comparison immediately, because you have all everything on your tablet. Okay. F5, ah, merci. Bon. Sorry.
C'est la dernière.
Ok. So to conclude. So it is essential to take into account the site as a whole, village and caves, because to understand it is capital. I think. The archaeological approach in this rock context is extremely important, as historical sources are rare. The conditions for those installations of type of site, at least, is partially due to the geological context. Well, there is a large presence of natural stone reserves who can be used as a quarry. And we really need to adapt methods methods of survey to those sites for good study. Thank you for your attention.